So good afternoon, everyone. And I'd first like to take this opportunity to thank the team here for putting together this conference and inviting me to speak on behalf of the work we've been doing at the Getty Conservation Institute, along with our museum and the colleagues here, on the analysis of early French calotypes from the collection of the Jean Paul Getty Museum. Our work on the analysis of the paper negatives in our collection stems from what Bertrand mentioned earlier on in his talk, and that's the Real Ideal exhibition that was held at the Getty on looking at photography in France from 1847 to 1860, back at the end of 2016. This exhibition gave us a really good opportunity to take a look at a number of the paper negatives in our collection to a very great extent, to do quite a battle of analysis on the materials. So in order to thoroughly characterize these papers and these negatives, what we did was a range of analytical techniques, many of which Celine mentioned in her work. First, we performed morphological analysis in order to document the thicknesses and weights and dimensions of the photographic papers or negatives. We performed multiple colorimetry and gloss measurements. We also performed microfade testing on our samples, X-ray fluorescence spectrometry for elemental analysis, and then two forms of Fourier transform infrared spectroscopy in order to characterize the organic materials present, in particular, the coatings on these paper negatives. So in our analytical study of these French calotypes, we had an opportunity to analyze 15 negatives from our collection, much smaller than the 133 samples Celine had an opportunity to look at. So the 15 negatives were created by six different photographers, Lesec, Flacheron, Mollard, Negre, Renault, and Robert. And we only had a few negatives by each, and often just one negative by a couple of the artists. Now, it's a little bit hard to draw any broad conclusions on the working practices or materials of a particular artist, but with the work that we've heard being done here by others like Celine, you know, it really speaks to the collegial exchange of information becoming a powerful tool to answering questions related to the material practices and materials used by a lot of these artists and groups of artists. I've outlined here the calotypes in different colors, and I'm going to maintain these colors throughout the talk. So if you're interested in a particular artist, you can just keep an eye out for that color palette. So this is the same image you see previously, and all I've done here is scaled all the images to the proper size. So you can see the relative size to most of the images. They all come very close in size. And when we take a look at the actual outlines of these images, and I've attributed them to a particular artist, you can see that the large majority of these calotypes fall under very similar sizes. And for example, 10 of the 11 prints by Lesec, Negre, Robert, and Flacheron are almost identical in size. They all have an average measurement of about 24.5 by 33 1/3 centimeters. And they all fall within 2 centimeters in either direction of that measurement. The one Negre that you see at the top that's substantially smaller actually turns out to be exactly 1/4 of the size of the larger papers. So strongly suggesting that he took one of the larger papers and just cut it into quarters. The three prints by Renault and the one by Millard are the only ones that seem to significantly deviate from the rest of the sizes. And here's just an overlay of those same colors and images. And once again, you can see that how close in size the large majority of these prints, 10 out of the 11 prints, fall. And it's only, again, only the three Renaults and the one Millard that fall outside of that standardized range. So I think it'd be really interesting. I'm not a historian of photographic cameras and plates, but I think it'd be really interesting to see if that 24 by 33 measurement corresponds to a particular plate size or camera size, because it seems to be a common thread in a lot of these paper negatives. So here is a plot showing the thickness of the analyzed papers that we took a look at. Again, we took a look at 15 negatives, and I've separated it here by the artists. And one of the things you can quickly start to see is that there's considerable variability in the thicknesses of the papers used. For example, and then, I'm sorry, but the watermarks you see, the WMs you see shown at the top, are the four images that contain watermarks in our set. So the range of thicknesses in our survey of the 15 negatives range from 68 microns in thicknesses all the way up to 122 microns, almost double the thinnest paper used by Robert. And you can also start to see that even within the work of a particular artist, there's considerable variation in the paper thickness used. And one of the other interesting points was that even when the paper, you look at just the Wattman papers, they still have a pretty good range in terms of their paper thickness. In fact, they vary in range from 79 microns to 105 microns, so roughly about a 33% variation in their paper thicknesses. And the other thing, and I'm not sure if this was true for Celine's results as well, we didn't see any French watermarks on any of the papers. And I don't know if that's just less common in France to watermark papers, but it was surprising to see, one, sort of the extent of the British paper use out of just looking at six artists, seeing that at least three of them used British papers for some of their work. But there was no clear evidence of French papers being used, at least not according to watermarks. The next type of analysis we performed was the microfade testing. And microfade testing is a technique that performs an accelerated light fading test of an object in order to provide us with predictive light sensitivity information on its possible display and storage. So here you can see that the microfade tester that was utilized for the Getty's work is a Paul Whitmore model, MFT, and it uses a xenon light source operating at 5 million lux, and it has a spot size of about a half a millimeter. So what we do is we illuminate the object, and in real time we observe the reflectance spectrum to monitor any change in the object's color, or any shift or change in the object's color. Oh, sorry, goodness. Script that one real quick. And this is the results of the microfade testing. So we tested both the Dmax and Dmin. And if that's not a term you're familiar with, we use Dmax to describe the high density, so the darkest part of the image, and the Dmin to describe the lightest part of the image. So it really corresponds to the paper material primarily. And you can see that there's a number of really sort of interesting points in here, and that they show up easier in the table here, and that's that three of those negatives showed a remarkably low blue wool rating. And by blue wool rating, what I mean is that any object that has a lower blue wool standard equivalence rating, it's more light fugitive. So in this case, the lower your number, the more light fugitive you are. And typically, we don't display anything that has a blue wool rating of less than 2. So just keep an eye out on these three in particular, because I'll return to those when I talk about the XRF results for the same analysis. So this is the XRF analysis that we performed. We used two XRF instruments to perform the primary work on our analysis of the paper negatives. For most of the work, we rely on the handheld Bruker 3V, which as you see on the left-hand side, and it's a handheld and portable XRF utilizing a rhenium tube and aluminum copper filter. The instrument on the right is a lab-based Artex Bruker micro XRF, and it has several advantages that allow us to answer specific analytical questions that we aren't able to answer with the handheld instrument. So when we do analysis, we typically choose multiple spots for analysis. We typically analyze the darkest part of the image multiple times, the lightest part of the image multiple times, and any support material that may be present. So we'll analyze any mounting material, any board material behind the object. And that's primarily because the X-rays, especially when you're dealing with photographs, when they're paper photographs, penetrate the entire object and the entire presentation package. So the spectrum you really get is a spectrum for all three or more products that you have. So it's the image, it's the paper, it's the support material behind that. And this was just sort of a good example of one of those images. So here what you see is you see the Dmax in black, where we see the highest amount of silver. You see the Dmin in blue, the lowest amount of silver. And you see the paper support material, or not the paper, but actually the mounting board that's behind it in red. And what you see is that the mounting board seems to have the majority of the calcium, while the image layer, not surprisingly, is composed primarily of silver. So this helps us, the reason we do the Dmax, Dmin, and any support material is to help us distinguish from what layer the signal's coming from. Is it coming from the paper, is it coming from the image, or is it coming from the board? And this here is actually a spectrum. I was trying to reduce the number of spectra I used in my talk. I don't think I was so successful. But this is a spectra of all 15 negatives that we tested. And I only put this on here just to show you guys all the elements that we were able to detect in these paper negatives. So not surprisingly, we see silver and halides all from the image layer. We see lead, we see iron, we see calcium. Those are all primarily coming from the either the paper or from the image layer in regards to lead as part of the processing. And then we see cobalt and arsenic, which also is coming from the paper in this case. But as Celine mentioned, you know, it's highly indicative of the presence of smalt, a blue pigment used to counteract the yellowing of the photographic paper. And these are the three I asked you to remember previously, the three that scored really low on the blue wool standard equivalence scale. And I was going to show you the XRF results for those. And this is what you see, that the all three negatives still have the presence of halides. So they still have the presence of light sensitive material. They have the presence of silver, iodine, and bromine. The Lasek is the one that had the strong bromine signal, while the Millard, the Flacheron, and Lasek all had a slightly lower signal for iodine. What was interesting here is that the Millard actually, even though it has the bromine and the iodine, has the highlights that seem to have darkened the least. A little bit surprising for the results. And this is the smalt that Celine was talking about. So what we did was we took a look at all four negatives that had the presence of cobalt and arsenic. And when we expanded that, what we quickly noticed is that the amount of cobalt and arsenic seemed to correlate. As one increased, the other increased. As one dropped in signal, so did the other. So we're really interested in to determine, you know, is this really a correlation, or is it just coincidental that the two occurred that way? And that's when we turned to some of our more interesting instrumentation, like the ARTEX, where we're able to better pinpoint our analytical techniques, and gives us also more ability to narrow down our analysis spots as well as perfect our analysis conditions. If you haven't seen smalt, this is a picture of a sample from the National Media and Science Museum in Bradford of Talbot type era paper. And what you see highlighted with the red arrows are smalt particles. The portion of the sample depicted here is approximately 1.2 square millimeters. And if you were to count the spots, there's approximately 20 particles of smalt in just one small little section. Now, when we use our handheld XRF, that has a window of about 42 square millimeters. So if you were to do the math, you'd be looking at approximately 700 particles of smalt. So it's no surprise that we see pretty good signal for both cobalt and arsenic, assuming they're both coming from the smalt particles. So this is our ARTEX system. And it's a micro XRF, and it has several advantages, as I mentioned, over the handheld system. And the two that we really wanted to take advantage of was the ability to do much smaller analytical spot sizes, so we're not averaging a large area, but we're actually getting much smaller and tighter when we do the analysis on the smalt particles. The other advantage of the system is that it allows us to do line and area scans. So instead of picking spot by spot, we can just travel along the image and see how the elemental composition changes as we move across the image from Dmax to Dmin, or in any direction we choose to move. And this is the results of the spot scan. So this scan was performed across a distance of about 10 millimeters, taking a measurement every half a millimeter, and with a 65 micron spot size. So across this 10 millimeter line, we've taken 21 measurements. And what you see is the normalized signal for cobalt in blue and arsenic in red. And you can clearly see that they behave exactly the same. Every time the cobalt signal goes up, the arsenic signal mirrors it. And every time it drops, the arsenic signal does the same. So this is a strong indication that both elements are part of a single component, in this case, most likely the small particles. And this is just a summary of the XRF results, distinguishing the elemental makeup and where the elements are coming from. Lead's a little bit of an issue for us. We've seen lead, as Celine mentioned, we've seen lead as part of the development process, but we've also seen it added in just paper. you know, whether it be for weight or as a contaminant, we do see the presence of lead in regular paper without any of the photographic chemistry being present. And of course, not surprisingly, the image materials are all silver and the halides. But what is interesting is that really the elemental composition of these papers and the paper negatives was actually pretty simple. There was only a few elements used. They seem to be very small in terms of the experimentation. They seem to have settled in and used pretty much the same at least elemental compositions to create their images. And the papers are relatively clean. We don't see a lot of additional additives in the papers. And this is a summary of the XRF result, just showing you sort of what we've, some of the more interesting things we've identified. So we observed cobalt and arsenic as part of the small in four of the 15 papers that we analyzed. We also were able to identify the presence of halides in three of the paper negatives analyzed, all of which correlated with their low rating on the blue wool standard equivalence. And finally, we see three other leads, calcium, iron, three other elements, calcium, iron, and lead, that were all detected as components of the paper, although the lead is still a little bit of a question if it's actually part of the paper or maybe part of the photographic process itself. The next step we did was to perform organic analysis to try to identify the coating materials present. I won't go into the details on the technique. Celine mentioned that earlier, but I will tell you that we have two instruments that we used primarily for this, and I've listed some of the advantages and disadvantages. So we have our SenseIR Traveler, which is an ATR FTIR instrument. And the benefits of using ATR is that the spectra really require little to no processing to compare them to a library match. And the existing spectral libraries actually work pretty well with ATR spectra without having to do any corrections other than some basic treatments of the data. Of course, the major disadvantage is that contact is required with the instrument. The advantage of reflectance IR, which we perform on our Hyperion 3000, is that it's not a non-contact technique. But unfortunately, the spectra created by reflectance often have to be converted using mathematical corrections to be searched against existing spectral libraries. Most spectral libraries are made in transmission mode, and reflectance spectrum don't correlate to those libraries. And I'll show examples of that coming up. So I mentioned we had a couple of custom modifications that we did for our ATR instrument to sort of minimize any possible damage of the photograph. And one is we had the diamond window. Normally with ATR, FTIR, you have a small crystal that protrudes that you need strong contact with. And that can be a problem with photographs, especially coated objects leaving an impression on the material. So our diamond window is actually flush mounted. It's completely planar with the sampling platform. And the other modification we made is that we extended the sampling platform by 9 inches. That allows us to reach into different areas of analysis we wouldn't be able to reach if you look at the instrument, how it comes as is. You only have a couple of inches that you can reach into an object. But because we deal with a lot of things that include like things like mounted photographs, sometimes that board can be a few inches wide on its own, and so reaching into the photograph can become a problem. So this is sort of a spectra for two of the negatives we analyzed, and all 15 negatives, and these are ATR, FTIR spectrums, but all 15 negatives fall into one of these two categories. They either really have a really strong FTIR signal, which you see at the top for the gray image of Notre Dame, or they have very little signal, still some, but not much more detail here and this is Renault's river landscape. And I've highlighted here some of the regions talked about earlier that correlate to beeswax. So typically, if we see beeswax coated on the photograph, these are the peaks we're looking for. We're looking for carbonyl stretches here. We're looking for CH stretches here, carbonyl, and the CH bends over here. And that typically indicates the presence of beeswax. So on the top image by Negre, you can clearly see that no problem analyzing and identifying the presence of beeswax. On the bottom image of Renault, you see a much lower concentration of the material. So what we see is we see some of the CH stretching, good indication of wax because of the strength of that signal. And we start to see a little bit more detail here where we start to see a little peak appearing and we see a little shoulder here, which gives us an indication that this could be beeswax, but it's not conclusive in its analysis. And just to further illustrate that point, what I've done here is taken the top image, which is a Tarascon by Charles Negg, and I've highlighted some of those portions. So here's again, these are the markers for beeswax. In red, you see what's typically markers for cellulose. And here I've taken just a sample of pure beeswax on its own, and you can see how nicely the peaks line up with the image up top. And then we have paper at the bottom, and this is just pure cellulose Wattman paper. And again, you can see no real signals here, and then you see all the paper markers, which we again see here. So this is a good indication that this is a paper coated with beeswax. So to further illustrate this point, the paper negative at the top is Saint-Honorat by Charles Negret, and where we were able to confirm the presence of beeswax. Below it is the spectrum, is the same spectrum, but taken and treated with a Kramer's corona condition treatment. So what I'm doing here is I'm looking at a reflectance spectrum. So this is the non-contact version of the technique that was being used here. And here I've taken it and I've converted it using a Kramer's corona transformation. So what I mentioned earlier is that the reflectance spectrum often require a lot of data treatment in order to process them through spectral libraries. And there's a couple of ways you can treat that data. And the two typical ways are to use a Kramer's Kronig conversion, which is typically used for specular reflection. The bottom one, the next spectrum, is one that's treated with a Kubelka-Munk transformation, and that's used for objects that exhibit diffuse reflectance, typically. The problem with coated paper negatives is they actually don't exhibit specular or diffuse. They exhibit a combination of both types of reflectance. And that can make the treatment much more cumbersome and much more difficult. While ATR, which you can clearly see at the bottom, requires very little treatment and can quickly match up to the spectral library sample, much easier than either of these samples. Now, this is not to say that reflectance spectrums aren't useful. They can actually provide a lot of useful information. And they can sometimes provide detail that you don't see in the ATR spectrum. For example, you start to see a small peak here, which we don't see in, I'm sorry, not there. I believe it's over here. You start to see a small peak that I haven't highlighted, but there's a small hump here that starts to show up in the reflectance spectrum that's also a marker for beeswax, but we don't see in the other spectra. And this is sort of a summary of those results. So this is a summary of all of our results, actually. So this is XRF data, FTRR data, and the physical dimensions of the materials we looked at. I've highlighted in red sort of the halides that we saw. You see in blue some of the small particle papers, and you can also see in green where we were positively able to confirm the presence of beeswax, while most of the other samples, because they fall into that category, we don't have a great FTR signal, we can see that it's some kind of wax, likely to be beeswax, but we can't confirm it based on the data that we had seen previously. Now, in regards to our future work, so we're still currently working on a lot of this work. One of the things we really wanted to do in this regard was to really expand our capabilities in identifying the organic coatings on a lot of these paper negatives. If you're familiar with the work of like Leanne Daffner, when she worked on the flush around negatives at the Harvard University collection, they performed a GCMS analysis, which is a destructive technique, but they were able to identify several admixtures present in these coating materials on Flacheron. And so while FTAR is a great technique in the fact that it's non-destructive, it requires a reasonably decent concentration of material. As you saw, 12 of the 15 negatives we looked at had very low signals. So by using GCMS, we get much better sensitivity, although it's a destructive technique. But the beauty of a technique like that is that it uses chromatography to separate the different components in the system. So it's what's eluting and what you're detecting are the mixtures, but separated one component at a time. And then the other thing we want to do is we're taking advantage of chemometrics. So basically multivariate analysis, principal component analysis, different statistical tools, to take a look at our data that we've already collected and data that we're currently creating using this whole range of standard materials to see if we can better identify and better separate and teach the system, the reflection IR, to separate different types of coating materials. And then finally, I'd just like to thank a lot of the people who are involved in this work, the team here, my fellow scientists at the GCI and staff at the J. Paul Getty Museum who were all part of this work. And I'd also like to quickly thank to the organizing committee for getting us out of Los Angeles this week. Many of you may have heard, this is the Getty Center and this is a Skirball fire. This is an image I took off the news yesterday, sort of showing you the proximity of our Getty Center. So it's a nice time for us to be in Paris and also out of the 100 degree heat. Thank you.
Merci beaucoup, Art Kaplan. Est-ce que vous avez des questions à poser à notre intervenant? Oui.
Hi, Art. It's Michael Pritchard from the Royal Photographic Society. And I just wondered if you could maybe give an insight or whether you consider how materials might have changed through, say, oxidation or structural changes or migration of materials from the mid-1850s up to 2016, 2017 when you're testing. Yeah, how realistic are the results that you're getting today compared to if you'd been doing your tests back in the 1850s?
Yeah, absolutely, that's a consideration. And the best way we have of accounting for that is that the standards we prepare, so in this case, I've prepared 60 different coating standards. So we'll take half those standards and we'll subject them to accelerated aging tests, where we'll control light exposure, humidity, temperature, and we'll age them artificially for several months, or depending on the protocol we choose, a couple of weeks, several months, maybe longer, and then we'll go back and we'll retest those materials and see comparison to see what changes. Because especially when you're dealing with a technique like GCMS or PyGCMS, a lot of those small changes, like the oxidation of material, can be easily identified, and the eluting marker compounds change.
This is not a question; it's mostly a comment. Since Art mentioned that there is no reference library exists for specular reflection FTIR. I just want to, jump in and to say that actually, for the last 4 years at Harvard University, we worked on building this library of most common coatings from the 19th century.
Yeah, and I have to apologize. If I said they don't exist, I would be mistaken. They don't typically exist commercially, but a lot of institutions like us and you build them in-house as custom libraries because a lot of our work requires us to do non-contact analysis. So yes, I'm aware of your work, and I misspoke if I said that.
Yes, and yeah, I'm just letting it out that there's a large number of coatings actually were analyzed with specular reflection FTIR, and the library exists, and it's open source, and it's we own it for now, who is we? Weizmann Preservation Center at Harvard Library and Center for Nanoscale Systems at Harvard. And we actually seeking for more samples analyzed with specular reflection FTIR to include into our library and build it up. And also we, Arthur McLelland, senior scientist at Center for Nanoscale Systems at Harvard University, he built a protocol document for FTIR, for reflectance, which is a very important document to follow to make this spectra read much easier and clear without any alteration to it. So just...
You guys are using the raw reflectance spectrum.
That's right. We're just averaging it. That's all. So... Thank you, Arthur.
No. Ask a question. I have a question, and this I don't know if this is for you, maybe it's for Céline, maybe it's for some of the photographers here in the audience. But I'm very interested in the finding of the halides in these negatives and the use by the photographers of bromide or iodide as a stabilizing, you know, I use stabilization over fixation. How many images could one print for a negative from a negative that would be stabilized like that?
That's a concern, but I think one of the photographers here, maybe Martin, could answer that much better than I look at a few things, but I look at things in collections, which typically we don't have much of a history on in terms of how many negatives were printed from. So it hasn't been my experience to really do a study like that. But I think a practicing photographer, much more.
I guess the second part of that question would be, I mean, we've learned from Mike Ware that the iodide stabilized prints will fade, actually, and the bromide stabilized will darken. So again, maybe for the photographers, is that a phenomenon that you've been seeing, depending on which halide was used or the combination?
From the three images that had halides here, they don't seem to have faded. None of those. Two of them had just iodine, and those don't seem to have faded. They seem to darken, if anything. And then the one Millard, which doesn't seem to have darkened at all, the highlights are really white, which had bromine and iodine, seems to have stood up fantastically. But I'm not sure. It'd be interesting to know if anyone knows how many positives were made from these in collections, how many exist, to better get an idea of something like that.
Alors on va prendre une dernière question.
So if you found halides, does it mean that it's not fixed? Or when do you know when it's fixed?
Yeah, it could be incomplete fixation, or it could be stabilization using those salts. This would require you following historical recipes, making a series of standards, and doing the analysis. I know you want to say at your organization is doing some of that work. But that's something that requires work that we haven't had the opportunity to do yet. But maybe Martin, some of his samples will fall under those categories.